الله الله الله
الله. Par excellence presents Jewels from the Holy Quran, a series of lectures by Mufti Ismail ibn Musa Menk.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. In the name of Allah, most gracious, most merciful. الحمد لله وكفى والصلاة والسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى. All praise is due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Blessings and salutations be upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. الحمد لله الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله. We praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for having guided us to this deen and for having given us this goodness, having made us from amongst those who are following Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Had it not been for the guidance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we would have all been astray. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept our deeds and our efforts, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us during this month of Ramadan, and may He soften our hearts. Honored ulama, beloved brothers and sisters, dearest listeners, Surah Az-Zumar, a surah wherein Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes mention of the groups that will be entering the fire and the groups that will be entering paradise and what they will be saying, how they will be entering. Before we get to exactly those verses, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about how He takes the souls away. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says,
Allahu yatawaffa al-anfusa hina mawtiha والتي لم تمت في منامها.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes the souls of the human beings away when death has been written for them, and He also takes them away during their sleep. Which means the connection of the body and the soul is being explained in this verse. At the point of death, the soul is extracted and removed from the body. But even when a person is asleep, the soul is taken out of the body. How exactly that happens, we have not been given the details. And that is why when we are waking someone up, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says,
فَيُمْسِكُ الَّتِي قَضَى عَلَيْهَا الْمَوْتَ وَيُرْسِلُ الْأُخْرَى إِلَىٰ أَجَلٍ مُسَمَّى.
In a person's sleep, when death has been written for that person in their sleep, we don't send the soul back. We leave it with us. So one of the easiest pangs of death, or what is known as sakarat, the final moments, one of the easiest pangs of death, when a person is asleep and they've died in their sleep, they've hardly felt that. Because the soul is taken away, in fact it is just kept after the point of sleep. And Allah continues to say that when we have written life for that person after they have slept, we return the soul, so the soul goes back into the body. And this is why when we are awakening somebody, we must make sure that we do it carefully. If you scream, or if there is a loud sound, you find the person gets up in a fright, or the person gets up and the heartbeat is actually not quite normal. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all understanding. Remember one thing, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has kept the knowledge of the ruh and the soul with Him. He has only released very little information. With us, we must be happy with what Allah has told us. The rest of it, we don't even need to want to know, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not tell that to us. Sometimes when it comes to certain aspects of knowledge, some people ask so strange questions, which we are not going to be asked on the day of Qiyamah. Like I know one person once came up to me and told me that, is it true that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will marry the wife of Fir'aun in the Akhirah? And I was sitting and saying, do you know what? Even if people have gone into the discussion, it is absolutely unbecoming of a Muslim to even question in that regard. Is Allah going to ask that to me? Subhanahu wa ta'ala. Is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala going to ask it to you? Is He going to ask it to anyone? Is there any mention of it in the solid evidences of this Sharia? If not, leave it aside. Let's worry about our salah and our zakah, and let's worry about ourselves. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us all strong. So the message here is, whatever Allah has told us, we know it. Whatever He did not tell us, we don't know it, we won't know it, we don't even have to ask about it. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala really grant us the understanding of what He has told us, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make that be enough for us, and may we not have minds that go beyond what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has permitted us to go. Then the famous verse, which we always repeat, the verse of the ultimate mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the forgiveness of Allah, the greatness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's mercy and forgiveness. We always repeat the verse. It is in Surah Az-Zumar.
قُلْ يَا عِبَادِيَ الَّذِينَ أَسْرَفُوا عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ لَا تَقْنَطُوا مِنْ رَحْمَةِ اللَّهِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَغْفِرُ الذُّنُوبَ جَمِيعًا إِنَّهُ هُوَ الْغَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ.
O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, inform those of my worshippers who have transgressed against themselves, never lose hope in the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, no matter what you have done. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive every single sin that you have committed. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive myself and yourselves. This is the verse of the hope of the mercy of the hope in the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us,
وَأَنِيبُوا إِلَىٰ رَبِّكُمْ وَأَسْلِمُوا لَهُ مِنْ قَبْلِ أَنْ يَأْتِيَكُمُ الْعَذَابُ ثُمَّ لَا تُنصَرُونَ.
Turn to Allah and submit to Him before the punishment overtakes you, and then it won't be of any help and you will not be assisted in any way. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us before that.
وَاتَّبِعُوا أَحْسَنَ مَا أُنزِلَ إِلَيْكُمْ مِنْ رَبِّكُمْ مِنْ قَبْلِ أَنْ يَأْتِيَكُمُ الْعَذَابُ بَغْتَةً وَأَنْتُمْ لَا تَشْعُرُونَ.
Follow the best of what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has revealed. Follow Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala before the punishment comes to you suddenly, and you won't even realize that the punishment is already here. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not do that to us. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, we don't want someone to come on the day of Qiyamah and say, oh, woe be upon me, destruction be upon me, I should have done something much better, I definitely was astray at that time. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, we don't want anyone to come and say, Ya Allah, give us another chance. Because we know that we will not get another chance. And Allah says in another place in the Quran, we've spoken about it here, that even if man was to be given another chance, man would still turn back to his bad ways and habits. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all understanding. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks of the fire. And then He makes mention of whom He is going to save from the fire.
وَيُنَجِّي اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ اتَّقَوْا بِمَفَازَتِهِمْ.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will grant success and He will save those who used to be conscious of Him during their lifetime. Those who used to be conscious of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, He will grant them savior from the punishment. He will save them in every way and they will be granted success. May Allah make us from amongst those who are conscious, as we've repeated time and again, that we need to turn to Allah. Out of human weakness, sometimes we falter and we fall. But we must realize that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to turn to Him. It is not difficult to seek forgiveness. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is waiting for that. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to forgive us. Then Allah makes mention of the groups. Listen to what He says. The first group, that group which is going to go, or those groups which are going to be entering the fire. They will be entering in groups.
وَسِيقَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا إِلَىٰ جَهَنَّمَ زُمَرًا.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, the kuffar shall be led into Jahannam in groups. Now do you know, when a person is going into a jail, when someone is being driven into the jail, are the doors of the jail opened and do they just walk straight past and in, or are the jail gates closed and when they get there, then they open, then they go in, then they shut again? We know that it is the latter, not the former. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about that here also. He says,
حَتَّى إِذَا جَاءُوهَا.
When these groups shall arrive to Jahannam,
فُتِحَتْ أَبْوَابُهَا.
That is when the gates shall be opened and they will be led in. And the gatekeepers will ask them a simple question.
وقال لهم خزنتها ألم يأتكم رسل منكم يتلون عليكم آيات ربكم وينذرونكم لقاء يومكم هذا.
The gatekeepers of Jahannam will say, didn't a warner come to you to warn you about this day and to warn you about this punishment? Did no warners from amongst you come to you? The answer will come,
قالوا بلى.
They will say, yes, definitely people came to us, but we didn't take heed. We didn't realize that this message was serious. May Allah make us from amongst those whom when messages get to our ears, it softens our heart and we turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so that on the day of Qiyamah, we are from this, the other group and not from this group that we've just spoken about. Who are the other groups? Allah says,
وَسِيقَ الَّذِينَ اتَّقَوْا رَبَّهُمْ إِلَى الْجَنَّةِ زُمَرًا.
Those who are conscious of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shall be driven into Jannah in groups also. Now, when you are invited to a palace and you get there, mashallah, when you get there, they are waiting for you. Red carpet. The doors are open. Everyone is welcoming you. Not that when you arrive there, then suddenly the big iron doors begin to open. No, they are waiting for you. You are a VIP and a guest. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes mention of that here.
حَتَّى إِذَا جَاءُوهَا وَفُتِحَتْ أَبْوَابُهَا.
When these groups get to the doors of Jannah, they will find the doors already opened. That is the difference between the two. One says, futihat abwabuha, which means the doors shall then be opened. And one says, wafutihat abwabuha, which means when they arrive, already the doors shall be opened.
وَقَالَ لَهُمْ خَزَنَتُهَا.
And the gatekeepers of Jannah will say, what do you think they will say?
سَلَامٌ عَلَيْكُمْ.
Peace be upon you on this day. طِبْتُمْ. You have definitely done lots of goodness.
فادخلوها خالدين.
You may enter the doors of Jannah forever and ever. Allahu Akbar. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us from amongst those, inshallah, who shall enter Jannah and who will be told to dwell therein forever and ever. The next surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has spoken about in the opening verses His mercy, and that is why it is named Surah Ghafir. Surah making mention of the forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, where Allah says in the opening verses, غَافِرِ الذَّنْبِ. It is Allah who forgives the sins. And another name for the same surah is Al-Mu'min, because in it, meaning in this surah, there is a story of a certain man from the family of Fir'aun who hid the fact that he was actually a believer in Musa alayhi salam, and he hid the fact that he was following Allah's commands. But from within the family, he kept on reminding the family of Fir'aun and the others to say, do you know what? This man, if he is telling you the truth, then punishment shall befall you. And if he is lying, it's going to be against him, not against you. So Allah makes mention of that in this surah. And that is why the surah is also called Surah Al-Mu'min. And in this surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about the angels and how the angels declare the praise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They believe in Allah and they literally seek forgiveness for all of us who are also believers. Listen to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us about the angels.
يُسَبِّحُونَ بِحَمْدِ رَبِّهِمْ وَيُؤْمِنُونَ بِهِ وَيَسْتَغْفِرُونَ لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا.
They praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And they seek forgiveness for all those who have believed. What do they say?
رَبَّنَا وَسِعْتَ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ رَحْمَةً وَعِلْمًا.
Oh Allah, you have encompassed everything with your mercy and your knowledge. Your mercy has encompassed everything and so has your knowledge.
فَغْفِرْ لِلَّذِينَ تَابُوا وَاتَّبَعُوا سَبِيلَكَ.
So forgive those who are seeking forgiveness, Ya Allah. The angels are making dua for me and you every day. Ya Allah, forgive those who are seeking forgiveness from amongst the believers. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us forgiveness. Imagine, could we have anyone higher than us calling out to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive us? We have those who are closest to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They are known as Hamalatul Arsh. They are the angels closest to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They are saying, Ya Allah, forgive those who are seeking forgiveness. Ya Allah, we are seeking forgiveness, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, forgive our sins. And they continue,
ربنا وأدخلهم جنات عدن التي وعدتهم.
Oh Allah, grant them Jannah. Grant them Jannah, Ya Allah. The angels are making that dua for us. Oh Allah, grant them Jannah and grant their family members Jannah. Those whom you have promised, Ya Allah, grant them this Jannah, Ya Allah.
وَقِهِمُ السَّيِّئَاتِ وَمَنْ تَقِ السَّيِّئَاتِ يَوْمَئِذٍ فَقَدْ رَحِمْتَهُ.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is being asked by the same angels for us. Ya Allah, safeguard them from evil. Ya Allah, protect them from evil. What is the biggest evil? The biggest evil is a person who comes on the day of Qiyamah and loses. That is the greatest loss, the biggest evil. May Allah protect us from the loss of the day of Qiyamah. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, making mention of the dua of these angels, that they say,
وَمَنْ تَقِ السَّيِّئَاتِ يَوْمَئِذٍ فَقَدْ رَحِمْتَهُ وَذَلِكَ هُوَ الْفَوْزُ الْعَظِيمُ.
The one whom you have safeguarded from evil, and the one whom you have safeguarded from the evil of that day of Qiyamah, is the one who has definitely succeeded, for that is indeed the greatest of success, the success of the day of Qiyamah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all success on the day of Qiyamah. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asks the question. On the day of Qiyamah, He will pose this question, and it is already mentioned here.
لِمَنِ الْمُلْكُ الْيَوْمِ.
Whose is the kingdom today? Allah will ask. When all those who claimed to be leaders and kings of the dunya, if that made them haughty and if that made them forget the presence of their own creator, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will ask them, right, who is the king today? Who is in complete ownership of this day? And all of us, every day, so many times a day, we read the verse,
Maliki yawmi ddeen.
Owner of the day of judgment is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that is why the response shall come in chorus.
لِلَّهِ الْوَاحِدِ الْقَهَّارِ.
This day belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one, the most powerful. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala really make us His true worshippers, and may He take us into Jannah, and may He grant us success on that day when He is the only one who will be able to grant us success. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about that man. That man from the family of Fir'aun who was hiding his iman. He says,
وَإِن يَكُ كَاذِبًا فَعَلَيْهِ كَذِبُهُ وَإِن يَكُ صَادِقًا يُصِبْكُمْ بَعْضُ الَّذِي يَعِدُكُمْ.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes mention of what this man said. He said, look, if this person is lying, if he is telling a lie, then it's going to be against him. But if he is telling you the truth, then the punishment will befall you. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. And this is why when someone comes to us giving us good news, and when someone comes to us warning us about the evil that we might be engaged in, we must regard it as a gift from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, regarding the same man, that he told his people,
وَيَا قَوْمِي, O my people, مَا لِي أَدْعُوكُمْ إِلَى النَّجَاةِ وَتَدْعُونَنِي إِلَى النَّارِ.
What is it that I am calling you towards savior and being protected, and you are calling me towards the fire? I am telling you that this is good and you are telling me no, it is bad. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the ability to distinguish between right and wrong. And may He also grant us the power to stay away from that which is wrong, and the power to engage in that which is good and correct. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then speaks about how the people of Jahannam shall be calling out to each other. There will be different types of people in Jahannam. Some of them will have been the leaders in the dunya. Some of the people will have been the leaders, and the others would have been those who followed them. Now when both parties go into Jahannam, those who were followers will then be saying to those whom they followed that, you know what, we followed you, so can't you shoulder a little bit of the punishment, because you guys were the leaders in the dunya. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes mention of this, and He says,
وَإِذْ يَتَحَاجُّونَ فِي النَّارِ.
When they will discuss with one another, and when they will be communicating with one another in the fire.
فَيَقُولُ الضُّعَفَاءُ لِلَّذِينَ اسْتَكْبَرُوا.
The weak ones who were weak in the dunya will be telling those who were the leaders and who were haughty in the dunya,
إِنَّا كُنَّا لَكُمْ تَبَعًا.
We were just followers. We used to follow you in the dunya. You were our leaders. You led us astray.
فَهَلْ أَنْتُمْ مُغْنُونَ عَنَّا نَصِيبًا مِنَ النَّارِ.
So are you going to shoulder even a little bit of the punishment for us today, seeing that we were just following you? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says,
قَالَ الَّذِينَ اسْتَكْبَرُوا.
Those will respond. Which means that the ones who were haughty in the dunya, they will respond.
إِنَّا كُلٌّ فِيهَا.
Definitely. We are both, we are all in the fire. We are all in the fire. Allah has decreed and decided that we will both be in the fire. How can we shoulder anything? It was your fault. And because of this, we must realize that when people tell us something, always ask yourself, is it right or wrong? If they are wrong, stay away from them. If they are right, then inshallah, that will be good news for us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us all strong. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about how the people of Jahannam will tell the gatekeepers of Jahannam. What will they tell the gatekeepers of Jahannam?
وَقَالَ الَّذِينَ فِي النَّارِ لِخَزَنَةِ جَهَنَّمَ ادْعُوا رَبَّكُمْ يُخَفِّفْ عَنَّا يَوْمًا مِّنَ الْعَذَابِ.
They will say, O gatekeepers of Jahannam, call out to your Rabb that he should make less for us this punishment, and at least give us off one day. He must give us off from this punishment. One day he must lessen the burden. Just one day. And the gatekeepers will answer with another question.
أَوَلَمْ تَكُ تَأْتِيكُمْ رُسُلُكُمْ بِالْبَيِّنَاتِ.
Did the messengers not come to you with news? Didn't they inform you of this day? Didn't they give you the clear signs?
قَالُوا بَلَىٰ.
Again the response will be, yes, they did come. The messengers did come.
قَالُوا فَدْعُوا وَمَا دُعَاءُ الْكَافِرِينَ إِلَّا فِي ضَلَالٍ.
So the response will come, you know what, you can keep on calling. The call of those who are kuffar will be all astray. It will not be listened to. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not make us from those who shall be cast into hellfire. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the next surah speaks about, in fact that surah is named Hamim As-Sajda, because it starts with the words Hamim, and in it there is a sajda. We read the sajda, and because of that, one of the names is Hamim As-Sajda, but it is also known as Surat Fussilat, because in the opening verses Allah describes the Quran as that which has made very clear, and that which has explained everything. So,
Kitabun Fussilat Ayatuh.
It is a book wherein the signs of Allah are explained. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the understanding. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks in that particular surah about his greatness. And he speaks about the kuffar once again. And he speaks about how they treated the Quran. And in the opening verses, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala poses the question. He tells Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to ask the kuffar of Quraysh,
قُلْ أَإِنَّكُمْ لَتَكْفُرُونَ بِالَّذِي خَلَقَ الْأَرْضَ فِي يَوْمَيْنِ وَتَجْعَلُونَ لَهُ أَنْدَادًا.
Ask them that, are you disbelieving in the one who has created the earth in 2 days? The one who created the earth in 2 days. You are now disbelieving in him and you want to associate partners with him. That is the question. Now, do you know sometimes when the non-Muslims look at the Quran and they think that they want to con the Muslims by telling them that there are contradictions in the Quran, one of the verses they use is this one. They say, look, in this Quran Allah says that he has created the skies and the earth and what lies between them in 6 days. And here Allah is saying he only created it in 2 days. So which one is right and which one is wrong? But that is very foolish. Why don't we continue reading the verses? Those verses where Allah spoke about 6 days, he says,
اللَّهُ الَّذِي خَلَقَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضَ وَمَا بَيْنَهُمَا فِي سِتَّةِ أَيَّامٍ.
Allah created the skies, the earth, and what was between it, what is between it, in 6 days. And here Allah says,
قُلْ أَإِنَّكُمْ لَتَكْفُرُونَ بِالَّذِي خَلَقَ الْأَرْضَ فِي يَوْمَيْنِ.
Are you disbelieving in that Allah who created the earth in 2 days? He didn't yet speak about the skies and what was between the two. And if you read the next verse, it says,
وجعل فيها رواسي من فوقها وبارك فيها وقدر فيها أقواتها في أربعة أيام.
Allah put the mountains and He distributed whatever He wanted to distribute, and He continued and He completed it in four other days, which means 6 days in total. So there is no contradiction. And this is why it is very important that when we don't know how to answer these questions, we ask those who know, so they can tell us, you know what, there is no contradiction in the Quran, because wallahi, I swear by Allah who has raised the skies without pillars, that definitely there is not a single contradiction in the Quran. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the understanding. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about what the kuffar used to say when the Quran was being read. You see, the verses of the Quran are so powerful that people who hated Islam, they went out, they were going out to kill the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, like Umar ibn al-Khattab. When the verses of the Quran pierced their hearts, 2-3 verses changed their whole lives. With Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, we know that he came out to kill Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Someone told him, why don't you start with your own family members? So he went to the house of his sister, and there, after a struggle, he heard the verses,
طَاهَا مَا أَنزَلْنَا عَلَيْكَ الْقُرْآنَ لِتَشْقَى إِلَّا تَذْكِرَةً لِمَنْ يَخْشَى تَنْزِيلًا مِّمَّنْ خَلَقَ الْأَرْضَ وَالسَّمَاوَاتِ الْعُلَى الرحمن على العرش استوى له ما في السماوات وما في الأرض وما بينهما وما تحت الثرى.
That was enough. He began to cry. He was weeping and he says, take me to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he went there and he declared his shahada. Because these verses were so powerful, the kuffar used to say what Allah mentions here.
وقال الذين كفروا لا تسمعوا لهذا القرآن والغوا فيه لعلكم تغلبون.
The kuffar used to say, do not listen to this Quran and make noise while it is being recited. Whilst the Quran is being recited, make lots of noise so that you can be successful and you can overcome and overpower the Muslimin. This is what they used to say. Now, what is the instruction that Allah has given us as believers? In another place in the Quran, Allah says,
وَإِذَا قُرِئَ الْقُرْآنُ فَاسْتَمِعُوا لَهُ وَأَنصِتُوا لَعَلَّكُمْ تُرْحَمُونَ.
The address is to us. When the Quran is being recited, be quiet, listen very attentively, try to understand it so that mercy can overtake you, inshallah. So that is the command for us. But there were the kuffar, and they were the ones who were saying, don't listen to it, make noise. In fact, they would put their fingers in their ears, as we have mentioned. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, on the day of Qiyamah, the same kuffar will be calling out. What will be the call on that day? Listen to what Allah says.
وَقَالَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا رَبَّنَا أَرِنَا الَّذَيْنِ أَضَلَّانَا مِنَ الْجِنِّ وَالْإِنسِ نجعلهما تحت أقدامنا ليكونا من الأسفلين.
The kuffar will say, oh our Rabb, show us those from man and from jinn who led us astray. We want to put them underneath our feet and literally stamp them so that they can be the lowest, because now we regret they led us astray. And this verse also draws our attention to good company once again. We must never have company that leads us astray. Never ever be in the company of those who take us away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Rather be in the company of those who can bring us to the houses of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks of that. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks of the one who has the best speech. And Allah says,
وَمَنْ أَحْسَنُ قَوْلًا مِّمَّنْ دَعَا إِلَى اللَّهِ وَعَمِلَ صَالِحًا وَقَالَ إِنَّنِي مِنَ الْمُسْلِمِينَ.
Can there be anyone better in speech than the one who calls towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala so positively? And he says, in fact, he himself does good deeds, and he says, I am from amongst those who have submitted to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This verse is encouraging us to learn, to put into practice, to say that we are submitters, and to go out and convey the message to others. Sometimes we are weak. We might not be able to communicate the message with our tongues to large masses and crowds, but it is not difficult to get a good book printed and distributed, or to get some cassettes copied and distributed, some CDs copied and distributed. If we do that, inshallah, it will be written next to our name that this person tried their best to deliver the goods and to deliver the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala far and wide. So it is not impossible. Let's not think that this only means that those who have the opportunities to get up in the masajid, they are being addressed. No, the address is for every single person. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala use us to spread the good word in one way or another. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, at the end of the part, the 24th part of the Quran that we completed tonight, He tells us that it is not Him who oppresses us. Allah does not oppress. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, مَنْ عَمِلَ صَالِحًا فَلِنَفْسِهِ Whoever does good deeds, those good deeds will help himself or herself.
وَمَنْ أَسَاءَ فَعَلَيْهَا
Whoever does bad deeds, it will be against his own soul or her own soul.
وَمَا رَبُّكَ بِظَلَّامٍ لِلْعَبِيدِ
Definitely your Rabb is not from amongst those who oppresses his own worshippers and his own slaves. So we should understand, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is looking for any and every excuse to forgive us. But have we given him that excuse? Have we even raised our hands once to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when we are sitting all alone in the darkest corners of the night, rolling down the warm tears from our cheeks or onto our cheeks, and we say, Ya Allah, forgive me, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, I've done so much wrong, Ya Allah. We know, we've heard, every day we hear about your mercy, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, I'm turning to you, Ya Allah. I promise you that I will not be the bad person that I was in the past, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, grant me the power and the ability and acceptance to be steadfast and make me strong. And Ya Allah, when you take me away with the shahada on my tongue, Ya Allah. And Ya Allah, take us all away in a condition that you are pleased with us, and not in a condition that you are displeased with us, Ya Allah. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabina Muhammad.